Okay, so here we go. Today is what, the 9th? Okay, so last time we were talking about area. And we had said that the way that we deal with areas of shapes is that we cut the shape into rectangles to make an estimate. And then we make the estimate better and better by using more and more rectangles. And then the calculus point of view is, let's just not stop. Let's just use infinitely many rectangles. Right? So then as far as calculus is concerned, the calculus point of view is that shapes that have area you can decompose them into infinitely many infinitesimal rectangles, find the area of each one, and then sum up the area. And that summation procedure is called integral. Okay? So that's a recap of last time. I also made a claim from last time. I said that this very long procedure that we did by cutting up that trapezoid into infinitely many infinitesimal rectangles, we're going to do it today in about 9 seconds, or 90 seconds. Okay? So now I've got to make good on that claim.
I mean, the part that made us all want to punch you.
Right.
Because I'm like, wait, we knew that.
Wait, we could have done this.
Yeah, we could have done bloody.
Okay, so here we go. This is section 7.4. And it is called the Fundamental Theorem of Calculus. Okay, so let's get right to it. Here's the theorem. So it's pretty much always abbreviated FTC. So let little f be continuous on the closed and bounded interval a to b. So a continuous little f. And let big F be any antiderivative of little f. Okay, so what does it mean for big F to be an antiderivative of little f? What does that mean? Okay, so I think what you're saying is that the derivative, that we know what the derivative of big F is. What's the derivative of big F?
Little f.
Little f.
The thing is flipping over.
That's good, a lot.
A lot?
Yeah.
It's not as bad as that one day.
Not as bad as that one day.
Yeah, the one day that it hung upside down.
It's still
seconds.
Early.
Well,
it had dust on the sensor.
Remember the sensor had dust on it?
Yeah, I'm not sure that was right.
Oh, that was the
rule
thing?
He was just looking at that.
That was
you're hypothesizing.
Well, it has a tilt sensor on it. I need to put even more under there. Here, look, we'll do this.
We seem to turn that tilt sensor off.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I think this is just an example of people trying to make a machine more clever than a person. And it's just not working right. I need to have a button that just turns it off.
Right.
Okay, we'll see. We'll see if that works for a little bit. Okay. So the derivative of big F is little f. That also can be interpreted as, remember what we said about antiderivative. Antiderivative is just taking this math sentence and writing it in reverse, which is to say that we know the antiderivative of which one?
Little f.
Little f. So antiderivative of little f dx is what?
Big F.
Big F.
Plus C.
Plus C. So this is the setup, right? These two things are not part of the conclusion. This is just the setup. So what we're saying is that suppose we have a continuous little f and an antiderivative of little f, big F. Suppose we have that. Then, integral from a to b of f of x dx is, okay, and I'm going to write something over here in a minute. But for now, what I want to remind you of is that this is that procedure that we did last time. This is taking a function between a and b, and then chopping up the region into infinitely many infinitesimal rectangles. That's what this procedure is, that long and arduous procedure. The fundamental theorem of calculus is saying that when you have this situation, when you're trying to compute the integral of little f, and you happen to have an antiderivative, big F, then the answer is big F at B minus big F at A. So what this is saying is that if you had an antiderivative to evaluate the integral, you just need to plug in two points, right? The left endpoint, A, the right endpoint, B, and then subtract. That's all that's necessary. Okay, so this is called the fundamental theorem of calculus. And it is really not too much to say that title is correct. It really is the fundamental theorem of calculus. The rest of the semester is going to be a consideration of all the consequences of this. We're just going to talk about this one way or another for the rest of the semester. Okay. I'd like to impress upon you about what this means. This integral procedure, it's saying that we're going to take this shape and we need to know everything that's happening inside. Right? We've got to cut it up, cut into pieces, infinitely fine, and then measure all of those pieces to compute the areas of all the pieces and then sum them all up. That's what this is saying. You've got to do all this work and be so careful, be so concerned about what's happening inside. The right-hand side is saying, actually, if you have an antiderivative, you only need to measure it in two places, on the boundary, just at A, just at B, nowhere in the middle. And this is the fundamental way that science works, okay? Because what science is you're trying to figure out patterns, right? The way things work, and you want things to be somehow regular. So, for example, if you're ill, and you go to the physician and you say, "Physician, I'm not feeling well." How would you react if the physician said, "Okay, lay on the table, I'll get my scalpel and open you up"? Right? I'd probably leave. How about you try my temperature first? Right? let's do that. Notably, right, your temperature can be measured from the outside. Right? You don't need to open someone up to do that. Right? Or, how about you get out your stethoscope? Something that you can measure from the outside. The reason why that works is because your body is regular, right? If it's well behaved. If you measure your temperature with a thermometer, then that's a very good indication of your internal temperature. It would be totally out of whack if you could measure someone's temperature, you know, with a thermometer, and then if you were to open them up and there's actually fire inside of them, right? That's not the way it works. That's not the way it works. What that has to do with the fundamental theorem, it's saying that suppose you have this really well-behaved function. Suppose you have a little f that is continuous, and not only is it continuous, but you have an antiderivative of it. This is a very well-behaved function. If you have a very well-behaved function, then you can tell everything you need to know about the inside just by measuring the outside. So put away your scalpel, doctor, right, and get out your thermometer. Good. So does everybody sort of understand conceptually what the theorem is saying? Good. So now we're going to use it as many times as possible today. But before we use it, we need one bit of notation. This is the evaluation bar notation. So this expression, h of x, and then a vertical bar on the right of it, and then a to b like this, is called the evaluation bar notation, and it is shorthand for h of b minus h of a. So, for example, the expression x squared plus 1 evaluated from, say, 2 to 5. So what does that mean?
It's like you compute it. Mm-hmm.
Right. You plug in 5. Right. You plug in 5, and then minus what you get when you plug in 2. Right. So as you said, this would be 26, and then minus 5 is 21. Or another example. 1 over t evaluated from 3 to 10 would be what?
1 over 10 minus 1/3.
Very good. 1 over 10 minus 1 over 3. And then you could simplify this if you had a mind to do so.
Or not.
Or you could just not. So, as a result, the fundamental theorem of calculus is frequently written like this. Integral from a to b of little f of x dx is big F of x evaluated from a to b. So the fundamental theorem of calculus is most frequently written in this way. But that's exactly what I wrote on the previous page. Okay, so one thing I'd like for you to note about the previous page is that I said this word, I said let f be any antiderivative of, let big F be any antiderivative of little f, any. Does that mean that there's more than one antiderivative?
Yes.
How many antiderivatives does a function have?
An infinite.
Infinitely many, right? So, for example, what is one of the antiderivatives of x squared? Antiderivative.
X cubed over 3.
X cubed over 3 is one of the antiderivatives. What's another one?
X cubed over 3 plus 1.
Plus 1, right? Yep. X cubed over 3 minus a million. That's another one. So this is saying that we're going to choose any antiderivative, whichever one you like. Okay? So now, that procedure that we did. So this is what we did last time. So do you remember doing that? Wasn't that? That was beautiful, right? Wasn't it? Okay, so then what that procedure is, it can be stated in this way. It was find the area between x is 0, x is 5, y is 0, and y is 2x plus 1. Well, it is this. Integral 0 to 5. Yes.
You normally don't say it from top.
No. No, it's always pronounced from 0 to 5. From A to B. Dx.
And B is always on top and A is always on bottom.
Yes.
Well, okay. let's do some examples, and then I think you'll get accustomed to it. Okay? So then notice that this looks like an antiderivative question. This is not an antiderivative question. This is an integral question. What is signifying the fact that this is an integral question to you? The limits, right? If they were not there, it would be an antiderivative question. Okay?
Those aren't the same thing?
No. Integral and antiderivative are not the same. So, now, we want to compute an integral. So last time we did the integral by chopping up the region in question into infinitely many infinitesimal rectangles. That's what we did. And we could do it again. Right? But the fundamental theorem is saying that, well, you're integrating 2x plus 1. If you happen to have an antiderivative of 2x plus 1, then you could actually just evaluate it twice. So let's find an antiderivative of 2x plus 1. What is an antiderivative of 2x plus 1? X squared. And then what?
Plus
no.
Plus x.
X squared plus x. What's the antiderivative of 1?
X.
Antiderivative of 1 is x. And then now, I could write plus c. I could. But remember what it says on the previous page. What word did I highlight on the previous page? Any antiderivative. So I could write, you know, if 12 was my favorite number, I could write x squared plus x plus 12. I could write the plus c in. But the reason why that's going to work is because now we're going to evaluate from 0 to 5. And if I had written plus c, then when I evaluate at 5, I would have gotten a plus c. And when I evaluate at 0, I would have gotten a minus c. And they would have canceled. So then, what is this expression evaluated at 5?
25 plus 5.
Right? 25 plus 5. And then what is this expression evaluated at 0?
0.
It's 0. And then what is that?
30.
And that was the answer from last time, wasn't it? So, from last time, right? So what do you like better? Right? They're both integral. What is this? What makes this so good? This is the fundamental theorem. That's what makes this good. Okay. Good. Any question about this one? So let's do another one. How about, please compute the integral of one from 1 to 2 of 4t cubed dt. So what do you think? Right. So the first question is, can we use the fundamental theorem?
Yes.
That's equivalent to asking, is this function continuous and do I know its antiderivative? So do you know an antiderivative of 4t cubed?
Yes.
T to 4, right? So t to 4, and then evaluate from 1 to 2. Well, that's 16 minus 1, so that's 15. And I'd like to point out what this line represents. This line is replacing 3 or 4 pages of trying to figure out how to sum the areas of infinitely many infinitesimal rectangles. So do you see the power of this? For the homework, there will be a question to cut it into infinitely many infinitesimal rectangles. But for all of the rest of the things, the fundamental theorem. Like these. I'm sorry?
Quizzes going to be this way and not the...
Right. Quizzes will be like this. Good. Okay, so now a bit of terminology. Well, you might wonder, then why did we go over that other thing in the first place, mm-hmm. kind of? The reason is because... The integral procedure, that's what it is. Is that as far as mathematics is concerned, shapes, the areas of shapes are reckoned as breaking them into infinitely many infinitesimal pieces and finding the areas of the infinitesimal pieces. That's mathematically the way area is defined. So it's hard to understand just why and just how fundamental the fundamental theorem is unless you understand what it is replacing. Right, the fundamental theorem, okay, is saying that you could do that big old long procedure, or you could do just a few steps. Okay, so you can't it's hard to put into context the importance of the fundamental theorem unless you do this other thing first. Okay, now if for scientific and engineering classes, they have to do it a lot, over and over and over and over and over. Until they get to the fundamental theorem, and then it's, you know, real happy times. Okay, so then here's two separate notions that visually look very similar. Okay, now, there's two different ones. What's the visual distinction between these? Right, this one has limits, A to B, and this one does not. So in our class, we call this first one antiderivative. Okay, and what do we call the second one? Integral.
That's why I was confused, because in the last class they called one definite integral and one indefinite.
Okay. Yes. And in elsewhere it is that is also another common terminology to refer to this one as indefinite integral. And this one as definite integral. So I'm going to use the red terminology. I'm going to say antiderivative and integral. Okay, and you'll just have to translate it in your head if you prefer the green terminology. So you might, maybe you wonder, why am I going to do that? Okay, so the reason is because, historically speaking, derivative and integral were totally separate concepts. They were developed at different times by different groups of people on different parts of the planet. And there was a wide expanse of time where it was not known the relationship between derivative, antiderivative, and integral was not known. It wasn't until it took a while until the connection was discovered and the fundamental theorem was known. So what derivative is, the fundamental idea of derivative is you want to find how fast something is changing, right? Geometrically, the slope of a tangent line. That's what derivative is. What integral is you want to accumulate the sizes of infinitely many infinitesimal pieces. Okay, so you want to accumulate things. So on the one hand, there's the one problem of trying to figure out how fast something is changing, and there's another problem of trying to figure out how to accumulate infinitely many infinitesimal pieces. And it is not clear just how these are connected if you're a novice, right? If you're just learning this for the first time. They are connected by the fundamental theorem. So integral, the reason why I'm going to call it integral is because that reflects the fact that integral is an accumulation procedure. We're trying to integrate all of these pieces. Okay, and it, to me, at any rate, it doesn't make much sense to refer to an antiderivative as an indefinite integral, because antiderivative is defined as the inverse image of a derivative. So this was the original terminology, and it comes from the original reason why these problems were addressed in the first place. This is historical revisionism, in my opinion, right? We're going to go back and name it these other names. It obscures what these problems were. So at any rate, antiderivative, integral. Feel free to call them this, but I won't. Okay. So we need some properties of the integral. So the first property is that if f is continuous on a to b and f of x is greater or equal to 0 on a to b, so if it is continuous and non-negative, then the integral of f on a to b represents area. So if that's f, then the integral from a to b of f of x dx is this area under the curve. So this is the area. Okay, if the function is not positive, then or not non-negative, if it takes on negative values, then you lose this connection to area. Two. If that's the case, if the integral from a to b of a non-negative function is area, then please tell me, please reason about this. What about the integral from a to a? What is this?
Zero.
It's zero. Why should it be zero?
Because there's no the same boundary points.
So it's not that it's a minus a, but what it is that imagine that here's these two separate fence posts, a and b. Yeah, and now put them on top of each other, right? So it's just one fence post. The question is that how much area is under there?
Zero.
None, right? So the answer is zero. So the geometric interpretation of this is that there is zero area under a point. So under a single point. Okay. Three. The integral from A to B of K f of x dx. What do you suppose I can do with that K? Factor it outside. Okay, so then now you might I suspect you might think that this is obvious from the pattern, right? Because, you know, we already established that antiderivatives do this. You can factor constants out of antiderivatives. But this isn't an antiderivative. It's an integral. Okay. We established that you can factor the constants out of sums, but this isn't a sum, right? This is an integral. So why should it be the case now that you can factor this constant out? So I'm not going for a proof, but let's try and think of why does it seem reasonable that this should be the case that you can factor a constant out? And saying that it looks like an antiderivative is not sufficient.
Because when you compute it, like if you were to do an actual equation and compute it out, you'd still be able to factor out that constant.
Yeah.
When you're doing it. So you can go.
I mean, it would negate.
So I think what you're saying is if you had an antiderivative, if you had a big F, what I'm asking, what if you didn't have a big F and you couldn't have one?
Well, if you pull it out, isn't your answer going to be, isn't it basically just the same thing?
Yeah, because it doesn't affect, if you find the integral of F of X, mm-hmm. It's not affected by whether or not K is big. So K can be pulled out. Because you can find that integral and then you...
Okay, but your argument, you're saying that this is true because it's true.
Yeah.
It is true, but that doesn't constitute an argument, right?
Does it go back to the fact that you said...
Yeah.
Yeah, we're just going to trust.
we don't really care.
What were you saying?
Does it go back to the fact that you said any derivative in the very beginning of it?
No, that's about the fundamental theorem. So this is true for any... For any function which is integrable, even ones that don't have antiderivatives.
I don't know what you mean by if you don't have the big F.
If there's no antiderivative.
There doesn't need to be. So after this is over, I'll give you a function that doesn't have an antiderivative.
So
I'll give you one.
Does it go back to the rectangles?
It does go back
because
to the rectangles.
What it's measuring is one of those areas under the rectangle. Essence is saying there's 10 of these, or 4 of these, or 2 of these.
Yes.
So it's just telling you
how many
of those integral areas there are.
Okay, good. Now let's think about this. In your mind's eye, imagine a rectangle. It has an area. Now multiply the height of this rectangle by 2. It's taller. What is the new area?
Twice.
Twice what it was. If you take a rectangle and you multiply its height by 5, its area is now 5 times as much. That's why this is working. That's why this works. Because what the integral is doing, it's looking at what the shape that f makes, and it's cutting it into infinitely many infinitesimal rectangles. If you multiply the height of all of these rectangles by k, then it will modify the integral exactly by factor k, because the integral is accumulating areas. That's why this is working. Okay? So, which is to say that if you take a little rectangle, and you multiply it by 2, right? You make 2 of them. Then that's the same as just one tall rectangle, one rectangle that was twice as tall as to begin with. So it's saying that you can break this rectangle into 2 pieces. Right? That's the reason why this is working. Okay. So the next one. Integral from A to B of f of x plus g of x dx. Okay, so it's going to do what you think it's going to do. So what's it going to do?
You're
going
to separate.
It can be split. So this will be integral from A to B of f of x dx plus the integral from A to B of g of x dx. Now, the antiderivative does this because the derivative does this. Okay, and the antiderivative is the inverse procedure, and it inherits that property from derivative. Derivative does it because of the definition, the limit definition of derivative. But that's not enough to say that that's why this one does it also. So why does this one do it?
Because it's like adding 2 areas together.
Okay, so think of it like this. Think in your mind's eye, imagine a rectangle, a tall one, and that the bottom part is painted red up to some height, and then the rest of it is painted green for the rest of the height. Suppose that you know the area of the red part and you also know the area of the green part. Then what is the total area? The sum of the parts. That's what this is saying. This one, this left-hand side, is looking at a rectangle that has a red height, f, and also a green height, G. So it's F high plus G high. So its height is F plus G. This one is saying that, well, the area will be the area of the red part, the area of the F part, plus the area of the G part. Good. So any question about this one? So that's the reason why it's going to work this way. Okay, the next one. And this one's more entertaining. as if we weren't having enough fun yet. Okay, so then the integral from A to C of f of x dx. So it's not A to B now. I made it A to C. Is the integral from A to B plus the integral from B to C.
It's like we would in the one right above it.
It's just like the one above it, except instead of making the division vertically, now we're going to make it horizontally. So this one is saying, suppose that Suppose that we have a function that looks like this. Suppose that this function is, so this is A, and this is B, and this is C. Suppose that we have a function that looks like that between A and B, and it looks like this between, it looks like this between B and C. Then the area from A to C, is it's saying, what is this one saying?
That's the total area.
It's
A to B plus B to C.
Yeah, it's you can take the red area plus the green area. That's what it. That's what this is saying.
But wouldn't they be two different
functions? No, it's a single function. Well, it's just a function. It's a function, right? So it's doing its thing, right? Doing its thing,
sure.
And then it says, you know what? When it gets to B, I'm gonna be different now.
Going crazy.
Yeah, just going crazy.
Okay.
Right? It's like it got to this point and it said, forget it. I'm gonna get a haircut. Did you have a question?
I had a random question.
Okay.
Since we can find the integral on the area of an odd shape like this, can you find the integral of a triangle?
Sure.
Or a square?
Yes. But understand what the exposition from last time was. From last time it was is that you knew some formulas from grade school, and then we forgot them. And then we redefined what area means. We defined what area means. And then at that point I said, and as a consequence, now you know all of the formulas that you knew at the beginning. So now you know them. Now you know them again.
But you couldn't do something with a triangle. You could.
You definitely could, yeah.
So just make it harder.
Right. It would just we could. You know what? I'll give you an exercise. I'm gonna write this down. Triangle. We can have an exercise where you establish the formula of a triangle.
Really?
No. Wait. I already did the formula for a triangle.
Yeah, we did.
I did it on paper last time.
You find the area of the rectangle and then you divide by.
I'm sure if we could do something for f of x dx. I find the area of the triangle.
Okay. So one more.
We really did do it the last time.
We really did do it.
Yes.
Okay, so integral from A to B of f of x dx is, now I'm going to write something that is not complete and therefore not correct. Okay, so what have I done? Thank you. Good, right? So notice that these limits are A to B, and these limits B to A. Okay? So then, what, algebraically, someone probably knows, what do you have to do to do this? You have to negate, right? If you change the order of integration, you negate. So,
is it possible that we'll see that?
We're going to see it a number of times today. So the reason why this is happening is because the areas that we're talking about are actually signed areas. Okay? So what I mean is that it is totally reasonable to have a rectangle with a negative area. Okay? I know that's a little uncomfortable to think about, but you know, in grade school, you could measure a rectangle, and if one of the side lengths is 3 and the other 5, then what's the area?
15.
Okay. And what if I told you that for the next 5 hours, because of your business, you're losing $3 an hour? Then how much do you lose? You lose $15. Mm-hmm. So then how much did you profit?
Negative 15.
Okay. So it would be just like, if there was a hole in the ground that was in the shape of a rectangle, okay, then you could measure it and see how much dirt you had to put in. Or you could say that there's negative 15 cubic units of dirt right there.
Or you could say it takes 15 cubic units
to fill it up. Okay, so then, however you want to look at it.
Yeah.
Okay, so effectively, what this is changing your perspective, right? You could say I lost $10 or I gained negative $10.
And if we're looking at like the xy axis, we're just talking about it going
right to left.
Oh, going.
Yeah.
Going to the left of the y axis.
Yes. This is traversing in one direction.
Uh-huh.
This one is traversing in the other direction.
Okay, that makes sense.
So to solve it, would you just switch it back and do it and like add a negative front?
We're going to do a number of exercises.
Oh, yeah. The number line is A and B. So A is 1, B is 3. So if you flip it...
I'm going to defer to examples. We're going to do a lot of them. But to satisfy your curiosity... We're going to do lots of examples. Okay, but here's a remark. It's not an example. So the integral from, say, 3 to 10 of e to negative x squared dx. So I could ask this. Okay. Now, there's no point in you attempting to evaluate this with the fundamental theorem. And the reason why there's no point in trying to use the fundamental theorem is because this function, e to negative x squared, does not have an antiderivative. There isn't one. Okay, so you might say, there just isn't one. There is no function whose derivative is e to negative x squared. Right? I could ask the question, can you tell me a function whose derivative is 2x?
Yeah, x squared.
Can you tell me a function whose derivative is 1 over x?
X to the negative.
Log x. Can you tell me a function whose derivative is e to negative x squared?
E to negative x squared. No,
The answer is no, you cannot. And it's not because you specifically, as a person or group, do not know the answer. No, the answer is because there is not one.
In the homework last night, there was a problem with...
There's a ton of those in the homework.
Exactly like that.
And they don't
there was other stuff with
it. In the homework, you probably had an X hanging out here.
Yeah.
And that's fine, because now in the... If you're doing this, you can do a substitution and say u is this and du is the rest.
Mm-hmm.
But
no.
you don't have an x hanging out here. So this is a function this is an antiderivative that you cannot compute, and therefore an integral that you cannot compute using the fundamental theorem. Does that mean that you cannot compute this integral?
Yes. Yeah.
No. It means that you It means that you have to resort to the definition of the integral. You have to break this into infinitely many infinitesimal pieces and add them up. So you might say to yourself, self, that's just something I'm really going to avoid.
Yes.
That will not be possible, because if you're taking any kind of money or math or science class of any kind, then you'll have to deal with probability and statistics.
Done.
And this integrals like these, it is not too much to say that integrals like these are of central importance in probability and statistics. So just a quick show of hands, who's taken a probability or statistics class? A few of you.
I've taken statistics.
Do you remember having to look things up in the Z table?
Yes.
That's what this is.
Well, that's fabulous.
That's what this is. Those values in the z table are numerical approximations of this integral. That's what they are. So you've already had to deal with it. Okay, I'm totally with you on that. But that wasn't the question. The question was... show me a function that doesn't have an antiderivative. And here it is. And if that if this did have an antiderivative, then there would not be a z table. You'd have a button on your calculator, right? They'd give you an expression to plug it into. You wouldn't have to do that arcane procedure of looking it up in a table if there was an antiderivative. Okay? So it's really true. So let's get to it. There is no. There is not. That's the point, is that there's not anything.
So if you wanted to be mean, you could put that on a quiz or something?
No, I wouldn't do it. No, I don't I'm not in the habit of doing that. Okay, I lost my place. Okay, so then integral 2 to 5 of 6x squared minus 3x plus 5. Okay.
Can I ask a quick question about that E stuff?
Yes.
Will it be on quizzes at some point?
What E stuff?
The antiderivative and derivatives of the E's and with
yes.
The X's and
the... But not the derivative of not the antiderivative of E to negative X squared.
Right.
Because there isn't one.
Okay.
Okay, so how about this one? How do we proceed? Yeah, find an antiderivative.
So separate it into three?
I don't think so.
You definitely could separate it into pieces. There'd be nothing wrong with that.
Is it necessary? But
it is not necessary.
Oh, okay.
And you'd have to write, if you were to do that, you'd have to write.
Let's do it in that.
Yeah. So let's just do it in our head. So tell me an antiderivative of this one. 2x cubed. And then?
-3/2.
Yes.
X squared.
Yes.
Plus
5x. Plus 5x. Okay, and then what?
The solid line
from
2 to 5.
Good, from 2 to 5. Any question about getting to here?
The 5x, I know that you talked about it, but I think I missed it.
Whose derivative is 5?
Not derivative of 5? What?
No.
Oh, the 5. We're doing antiderivative, not derivative. Got it backwards.
Good.
Thank you, sorry.
Okay, so then now we need to plug in 5. Okay, so this would be, 2 times 125 minus 3/2 times 25 plus 25 minus 2 times 8 minus 3/2 times 4 plus 10. The arithmetic is just boring, to be honest with you. I try not to give exercises on quizzes where the arithmetic is just like this. So, I mean, this is why we organized ourselves into societies and made machines to do this for us. Human beings are excellent at making machines and less excellent at arithmetic. Until they take over. Well. Okay, so now I lost my spot. Okay, so then minus.
Can someone else do the other thing?
Minus 6.
Yeah, I was like 2 times 8 is not 26.
No, but he added something to it.
Oh,
he added a 10 to it.
Tick-tick-tick.
Yeah.
Well, that's just weird.
Okay.
Wait, but I thought the negative.
It would be 20, so yeah. We might as well jump that far ahead.
Okay, so 275 minus 37 and a half. I said 5 and wrote 2. I'm not sure what.
What's your calculator? I know, I never plug it in. Oh, that would be problematic.
Yes.
And then minus 20. So that's 237.5 minus 20. So 217.5. Okay, so the arithmetic was the major part, right? I'd like to point out that the only calculus was right here. Mm-hmm. This was grade school stuff.
Maybe nowadays.
Any question about this? Okay, so I'd like to point out that we've done a number of fundamental theorem exercises, but one notable anti-differentiation technique has been absent. What?
The U substitution.
The U substitution. We haven't done any with the U substitution.
Okay.
So here it comes. Okay, so integral 0 to 5, x square root 25 minus x squared. dx. Sorry? Okay. Is it okay now?
It is.
Okay, so here's an antiderivative, right? So is this one of the antiderivatives we know?
No.
No. Is there an algebraic manipulation that we can do to turn this into one of the antiderivatives we know?
No.
I can't think of one. So then what's left?
Substitution.
A substitution. Okay. So then... So what do you want to select as a candidate?
25 minus x squared, please.
Okay.
But we want to keep the absolute, we want to keep the square root there.
There's nothing that can be done about the square root right now.
Yeah.
Yeah. So U is everything under the radical. Okay, so U is everything under the radical, and then if we're going to substitute U in, then what else must we substitute?
Du.
Okay, so then du is a consequence of u. So how do we figure it out? Good.
Negative 2.
Yes. Negative 2x dx. But we don't have negative 2x dx.
Did you just divide by negative 1/2?
Okay. Did you have a question? I skipped this step, but I hope that eventually you'll become comfortable to the point where this step is not necessary for you.
I'm just supposed to write everything. Okay. That's all I was trying to make sure that it was the same thing.
Okay. Good. So now at this position, we've been in a position like this frequently. But when we were anti-differentiating, not integrating. So notice that that means that this red x stuff, the red x stuff, is going to be replaced by this u, this red u stuff. So red getting replaced with red. This green stuff. Is getting replaced with this. And if this was an antiderivative, we would proceed. But this is not an antiderivative. What is this?
Integral.
An integral. And now we have new things. Right? Notice that what is going to become of the zeros and the fives? Okay, good. So then specifically, we need to know, since we're changing since we're changing from x's to u's, we need to know what u is going to be when x is 0. So u evaluated when x is 0, what is that?
5, yeah.
No?
No?
You got to plug in 0.
25.
25, right? You take the...
Oh, I'm sorry, not solving for plugging in.
Right. So you got to plug in x is 0, so then that's 25. And now we'll need to plug in 5. And what do you get if you plug in 5?
0.
Because we're switching from x's to u's. This is from x is 0 to x is 5. So if x is moving from 0 to 5, then how is u moving? From 25 to 0.
So, but can we switch? Can we change the problem to 1 over negative half times 5 over 0? And then we can change the numbers after the fact.
Okay, so after the fact, the answer is maybe. So I'm gonna solve this exercise in this way, and then I'm gonna come back and solve it in a different way, and those constitute the two major ways to solve the exercise. So you can choose among those which one you prefer. So does everyone see now that everything is accounted for?
Yes.
The red stuff is accounted for, the green stuff, the blue stuff. Okay, so now I'm going to make an error. So integral from 0 from 0 to 25 of, so that'd be square root u, and then du over negative 2. What do you mean? Isn't it from 0 to 25?
No. Because u of 0 is 25, so you have to replace it in the same location.
Good. So notice that what this line is saying, that when you plug in x is 0, you get u is 25. So the 0 has to be replaced with a 25. The 25 needs to be on the bottom. Notice that my error was putting it on top. So these are in the wrong order, okay, for the substitution. Okay, so this is not right. However, this represents a very common error that students make on an exercise such as this. So the correct answer, the correct substitution, is that it's the integral from 25 to 0, square root u, du over negative 2. Okay, so any question about that? So just be very careful about that.
How'd you get square root of u? How'd you get du over negative 2?
Because it may be difficult to see now. So let me rewrite the original integral without all the decorations on it. So that's the original one.
Oh, okay, yeah. Trump seems square root. I see it now. Thank you.
Okay, so then now this division by negative 2 can be factored out as negative half. -25 to 0. Square root u du. And so now I'm going to do something. There's nothing conceptually wrong with it being 25 to 0, but I can make it be 0 to 25. How? What do I get? What?
By multiplying by negative.
By negative 1, right? So if I switch the order of integration, if I flip it, that negates the integral, which would make this positive half, right? So yeah, I'm going to do it. Yeah. So I'm going to spend the half. Or spend the negative. And as a result, I drop the negative. And now it's integral from 0 to 25. So does everybody see the what occurred? It's no longer negative half, now it's positive half, and it's from 0 to 25. Okay, and then I'm going to write this as u to half. And now we've significantly altered the integral from where we started, so now the corresponding antiderivative, is it one of the antiderivatives we know?
Yes.
It is. So then this will be half u to 3 halves. Divide by 3 halves, and then evaluate it from 0 to 25. Now, you probably remember, maybe, last couple lectures ago when we were talking about antiderivatives, and I said something like, please don't simplify when you're computing antiderivatives. Now, are we computing an antiderivative?
No.
No, we're computing an integral. And we're about to evaluate this at two places. So it is probably in our interest to simplify. That's what I meant back in the day or whatever when I said that. Okay. Is that because we're going to evaluate now, it will be in our interest to simplify. So division by 3 halves is same as multiplication by 2 thirds. So this will be 1 third because the 2's cancel. U to 3 halves, and then evaluated 0 to 25. So this will be 1 third, and then 25 to 3 halves minus 0 to 3 halves.
Plug it back, plug the U back in?
No.
But if you do plug the U back in, you have to go back. You have to change the...
You'd have to go back.
Yeah.
So I'm going to answer your question on the next page.
So we don't put the 25 minus the square root.
No. So then what is 0 to 3 halves?
Zero.
And what is 25 to 3 halves? What is it?
I have no idea.
Not 75?
37 to 5.
No. Yes. What is that?
Hold on, it's coming.
Square root of 75.
So what's
125?
125. So the way this works, the way a fractional exponent works, is you do the fractional part first, 25 to half. What's 25 to half? 5. Then you do the numerator part. 5 cubed is 125.
I did
25. So 1/3 times 125. So 125 over 3. Any question about this one? So now the novel part, at least toward the beginning, the novel part of this exercise was we had to do this additional part, this playing with the limits.
Yeah.
So now another thing that's in common practice is you don't change the limits, which is, I suspect, maybe you did some integration previously and that's the way it was done. And that's fine. So we're going to do it like that now. So I'm going to solve the exact same exercise. So it was x, and then 25 minus x squared dx. So this is the same one. So I'm going to solve this again, except I'm going to solve it in a different way, and I'm going to do the parts that we've already done quick. Okay? So then we need to do a substitution. So u is 25 minus x squared. And then as a consequence of that, du divided by negative 2 is x dx. Now the next thing that we did, The first time we solved it is we went ahead and we substituted the limits. Okay, we figured out what the new limits would be. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to say, you know what, I'm going to hold off on that. I'm going to not do that. And I'm just going to do the substitution now. So 0 to 5. And then it would be square root of u du over negative 2. So now, I'm going to warn you now that what I observe when students, for some reason, like to do this, a certain fraction of students, they like doing it this way. However, of the students who do this, like 1 in 5 of them make the following error. They say, they look at this and they forget that this, what is 0 here? X is 0. And what's 5? X is 5. However, we're currently dealing with symbol u. So what happens is that you know, you get a little bit of tunnel vision, or you get anxiety for because you're on an exam or whatever, and then you do this as if you're doing this, and then you get it all mixed up. So if you're going to proceed in this way, then you need to write something to remind yourself that these are x's. So it's good to write something like this. So from x is 0 to x is 5, because otherwise you're putting yourself in jeopardy of forgetting that. Okay. So then, integral from x is 0 to x is 5, negative half, u to half, du, so negative half, u to 3/2, over 3/2, evaluated from 0 to 5. So that would be negative 1/3 u to 3/2 evaluated from 0 to 5. So that would be negative 1/3 and then 5 to 3/2 minus 0 to 3/2.
No. You have to plug the x function back in.
Well, I mean, I did it, right? I did this, no. And then it was from 0 to 5.
You have to plug the x function back in for you because the substitution, you was a substitution.
Ah, good. So does everybody see? I mean, if you just look at this, what I have written here, just at the end, it doesn't look wrong. It looks okay if you just look at this part. But what's wrong with it?
You have to remember that 5 and 0 are x's.
They're x's. Okay, so that's why it's a good thing I left myself some horizontal space so I could write x's, right? X, 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 x. Does everybody see that the mistake that was made was that I put these x's in for a u? You can't do that. Okay, so this is wrong. So the way you fix this is you say, okay, well, negative 1/3, and then it's u to 3/2, but u was this. So it would be 25 minus x squared to 3/2, and then 0 to 5. Okay, why did I drop the x equal now? Because we're back to x's, and we're not in danger of mixing things up. So this would be what? Negative 1/3, and then 25 minus 25 to 3/2 minus 25 minus 0 to 3/2. So -1/3, and then 0 to 3/2 minus 25 to 3/2. And what is 25 to 3/2?
What is 25 to 3/2?
Did you have a question?
No, I see.
Okay. And so 125 over 3. And yes, obviously the answer is the same as the previous exercise. Sorry?
It seems like you can make a lot more mistakes.
There's in my experience has shown me that students make more errors when they're attempting this method. My experience has also shown me that I have essentially no chance of changing anyone's mind about it. Okay, so I won't even attempt. Okay, but I will tell you that it seems to me that more errors are made by students who try this method than the first one. Okay. So let's do a couple more of these. Okay, how about integral 4 to 6 of 2 divided by 2x minus 7 squared dx? Algebra? What kind of algebra? Okay. What would that get you?
There's no x for u substitution. That's why I was saying.
What u substitution?
Well, if we were going to use the u substitution as the denominator.
As the whole denominator?
Yes.
I agree. You cannot do a u substitution where u is the entire denominator.
Well, 2x minus 7.
So you do alpha.
Ah, but could we just do the part that's inside?
Yeah. That's what but even then you don't have to.
Well, let me write it down and then you look at it and you tell me if your opinion changes.
Possibly. It's fair. Oh, you're right, because that's
your
u. Yes, I'm sorry.
Okay, good. So if
we're helping you.
If u is 2x minus 7, okay, then du is a consequence. Good. Do we need to do du over 2?
I made a mistake.
No.
Because
we have 2dx.
Because we have 2dx. Right? Okay, so then. For the rest of the examples, I'm going to change the limits.
Yes, I think that's a great idea.
So if I plug in 4, then that would be 2 times 4 minus 7, which is 1. And then if I plug in 6, that would be 2 times 6 minus 7 is 5. Okay, so any question about making this substitution? Yes?
Why did I get x squared minus 7x?
Because you anti-differentiated instead of differentiated.
Okay.
U is this, and to find du, you need to differentiate, not anti-differentiate.
Right.
Other questions?
No, that was one.
Okay, so then this would be integral
1 to
5, good. And then it would be 1 over u squared du. Okay, so now I'm going to make, if I assigned this exercise, then I would expect somewhere between 5 and 10% of students to do the following. So some of you are looking at your paper saying, that's what I wrote.
I don't get it.
This is not right.
It's incorrect. You do U to the negative.
Why is this not right?
Because it's not X. It's U.
It has nothing to do with the letter.
Because it's X on that. Because it's larger than 1.
Oh,
because
it's square.
Right.
It's not negative 1.
Because
it's
here...
Because it's not negative 1.
Here is the log antiderivative. 1 over u du. That's the log antiderivative. It says 1 over u du. What is the exponent for that u?
Ln.
1.
1.
1 over 1 over u to 1.
Or it's u to the negative 1.
And you can interpret that as u to negative 1. What is the exponent here?
2.
Not the same. Okay? I know that I agree that it looks similar. Visually, it's similar. But they're just not the same. That exponent being different, being a 2, is all the difference. It's all the difference. Okay, so then, does everyone see that this is not right? Okay, so instead... how do we interpret this one? Yes, we need to interpret it as u to negative 2.
But we still haven't found the antiderivative.
No,
we
haven't.
We're just rewriting it.
Yeah, I'm just rewriting it. And so now we're going to interpret it this way. And is this one of the antiderivatives we know?
No. Yeah, because when you find it, it's going
to be. Right. So it will be u to negative 1 divided by negative 1 from 1 to 5.
Isn't that just negative u to the negative 1?
Negative, yes. Because we took the exponent, negative 2, we added 1 to get negative 1, and then we divided by the new exponent. Okay, so then, yes, I agree that this could be written as negative u to negative 1 evaluated from 1 to 5. And I'm going to spend that negative and say that that's 1 over u.
Wouldn't you just flip that?
Yeah, I'm going to make this u to negative 1, 1 over u. And I'm going to, so I'm going to do it in two steps so that I don't cause grief for anyone.
Does it matter?
You'll get the same answer if you don't do that.
You will get the same answer.
Okay.
So, does everyone see that from here to here I spent the negative and changed the order of evaluation? Okay, good. So then it would be 1 over 1 minus 1 over 5.
Didn't you just put a log?
What log?
Because we're not doing it.
It's not integral. It's not antiderivative.
Not the antiderivative anymore.
Did you have a question?
Yeah. Just for a moment. The subtraction goes back to... I don't even know what concept. I can't even find it.
The fundamental theorem.
Huh?
The fundamental theorem.
Okay. But I thought I was doing addition earlier. Why am I now subtracting?
It has always been subtraction.
Well, I just added an extra y.
The 1 over here, you just multiply by negative 1.
Yeah.
Yes. From here to here, I spent that negative. Okay, so any question about this one? Here to here? Here, yes, antiderivative of u to negative 2 is u to negative 1 over negative 1. The reason why we're computing an antiderivative is because we're using the fundamental theorem. The fundamental theorem is what relates integral to antiderivative. Yes?
Yeah.
Here?
Oh.
Okay. Other questions?
Can we do these for the rest of the class?
We are going to. Except now we have to do something different.
So that goes back to the FB minus FA, right?
Exactly that.
Okay,
so let's do another function that doesn't have an antiderivative. Except we're going to have to work around it.
So many concepts.
So no, not this. Let's write it like this. Yeah, let's do it like that. Okay, that'll be fine. Yeah, okay. So integral 0 to 5, 3x minus 6 absolute value dx. Okay, so then let's write down the only three antiderivatives that we know. So we know antiderivative of u to n du.
Is that 13?
No. That's absolute value. All my threes, all my ones have a serif. Okay, so then this, so we know that one. We know the log one. And we know the exponential one.
Okay. We're saying that we know them.
Yes.
Can we show that we know
them, Elsa? If you're asking me to write them, I'm going to write them right now.
Oh, okay. Sorry for jumping.
So this one is u to n plus 1 over n plus 1 plus a constant. This one is, yes, log absolute u plus a constant.
Is that natural log or log?
Yes, natural log, e to u plus a constant. Okay, so now I'd like for you to observe that on the red part, notice that none of the antiderivatives that we know have absolute value in them, in the red part.
But
what?
The other one. The one.
But that's the right-hand side. So then we can't proceed from the left to the right if there's absolute values in here. Right. Do you see that this one has absolute values in here? This is absolute value. You could do your substitutions to your heart's content, but... You would still have absolute values in there, and you would not have this. You would not have one of these. So that means that, you know, we could resort that means that we can't use the fundamental theorem, is what that means. So if we are to compute this integral, then what we must do is we must resort to the definition. We need to chop this up into infinitely many infinitesimal pieces. Compute a limit. Wouldn't that be great?
No,
that would be terrible. Let's avoid that. Mm-hmm. Let's avoid doing that. So the way we're going to avoid doing that is we're going to make a trade. We're going to say, okay, we can't do this one integral, this one. So what we're going to do is we're going to make a consideration so that we can break this integral into a couple different pieces. And then each one of the pieces we can use the fundamental theorem on. Okay? So we can't use the fundamental theorem on this one because absolute value of 3x minus 6 does not have an antiderivative. But we're going to break this into pieces, and each piece will have an antiderivative. Okay? Exciting. I can see it on everyone's face. We're just... So, first thing, just to remind you, okay, so why is absolute value of x, just as something a little simpler, what does y as absolute value of x look like?
Above
x axis.
a V, right? It does this. Okay, that's what absolute value of X looks like. Okay, now that's not what we're integrating. We're integrating something that is like this. So 3x minus 6 is you take absolute value and you shift and scale it around. You've moved it around somehow. And then we still... in fact, it's not moving down. It's moving to the right. Yeah. So it's going to move to the right. So that's what absolute value of x looks like. And this absolute value opens up like a V, okay, just like this one, instead of being like a mountain like this. This one opens up, this one. Okay, so then now, what is the smallest that 3x minus 6 in absolute value can ever be?
-2.
What is the smallest thing that's going to be able to escape outside of that absolute value? Zero, right? You can't get anything smaller than zero to come out, right? So then, where does that occur? Where does, when
two.
Is,
at x is
2, right? So then the question is where?
Does that change the limit?
We're going to see.
Oh.
Where is the point, the vertex? For 3x minus 6, absolute value. Well, what we need to do is we need to solve for when 3x minus 6 is 0. So 3x in absolute value. So 3x minus 6 in absolute value is 0. Well, if the absolute value of 3x minus 6 is 0, then 3x minus 6 itself must be 0. So that 3x is 6, so that x is 2, just like you said. Okay, so then the corner, the pointy place, occurs at x is 2. So that means that what we're looking at...
Even though we have the antiderivative there.
What antiderivative?
Absolute value.
Never mind.
We don't have an antiderivative for absolute value. We don't have one. Okay, so... So at 2, it comes down. Okay, that's the point. And then it goes over to 5. So if you were to draw what we have, it looks something like this. And this is at x is 2. This is at x is 5, and this is at x is 0. So does everybody see the picture? What is the area that we're looking for?
0 and 2.
So, yes, can you see that it's this? There's a green part, and there's a blue part. Does everybody see that this absolute value, you know, it's doing its thing, and then it gets to 2 and it says, you know what, that's it, I'm doing something else. And then it goes off and does a different thing. So it changes its mind at 2. Okay? But does everybody see that if we could find this area and that area, then...
We have a property for
that. Ah, yeah, if only we could break it up... into two pieces, that'd be so great. Okay, but, and we're going to do that, but I'd like to ask, does anyone see a totally easy way to answer this question right here and now?
Pythagorean theorem.
Not quite.
Don't worry about anything.
There is an easy and obvious way to answer this question. Find the area of these two triangles. Couldn't you just measure them right here and now? What is this base?
Two.
That's 2. What is this base?
3.
Three.
Well, now you know.
This is y is absolute value of 3x minus 6.
Oh my gosh.
What is this height?
9.
9. How did you get that?
I plugged the 5 in for x.
Okay, you plug in 5 for x. 3 times 5 is 15, minus 6 is 9, absolute value of which is 9.
Oh my gosh.
What is this height?
6.
6. How did you get that?
Math.
You plug in 0, 3 times 0 is 0, minus 6 is negative 6, absolute value of which is 6. Base times height over 2, base times height over 2 will give you the answer. So I'm going to write that down, but we're still going to integrate it just for by plugging in 0. This y height is 6. Negative 6.
Absolute value
is 6. So the answer is 6 times 2 over 2 plus 9 times 3 over 2. So that's 12 plus 27 over 2, so 39 over 2. Now, if I give you an exercise that can be solved using geometry,
I can do it.
Please do it.
Okay.
It will be shorter. It will be more accurate. It will be easier for you to understand and easier for me to understand your answer.
I keep meaning to ask, what's the units on this, or does it matter?
There are no units.
Okay.
Square units.
I remember that question last
time. I was very frustrated.
Some units. Well, there's square units. You know, this could be. You can make it whatever you want. This could be 2 furlongs, and this could be 6 furlongs. This could be 6 square furlongs. So, we're gonna answer the question now, okay? So that you can see the integration technique, okay? But please understand that if I gave you this exercise. On a graded assignment, by all means, tell me that it's a triangle. Right, base times height over 2. By all means. Okay.
Can we have a geometry table with our formulas on it?
No. Okay. So then, what we want to do is the following. So what we need to remember. Is the definition of the absolute value of x. So the absolute value of x is x sum of the time. When is the absolute value of x? Even a little bit more generous, when x is not negative. To which you might say, what's the difference? What's the difference between positive and not negative?
Zero.
And you might say that's a pretty fine hair to split, but, you know, that's the same as asking, you know, some of you may have met a mathematician and wondered how they got that way, right? So how about, what is the formula when x is negative? What's the formula for the absolute value of x?
X less than 2.
Well, when x is negative, what's the formula? Negative x.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
What are we doing right now?
We are remembering the definition of the absolute value of x. So, for example, the absolute value of 5 of 5 is what? 5. What's the absolute value of negative 7?
7.
Negative negative 7.
7.
Which is 7. What's the absolute value of negative 12? Negative 12. Which is 12. So the absolute value of x is always either x or negative x, depending on the SIGN of x. So my question to you is, how about 3x minus 6 absolute value? Some of the time, it's going to be 3x minus 6. And some of the time, it's going to be negative 3x minus 6. And my question, just like this, when is it going to be 3x minus 6?
When it's not.
And when is it going to be negative 3x minus 6?
When it's not, when it's not negative.
Okay, and
it's
when is 3x that?
3x minus 6.
And when is that?
Oh, all numbers greater than 2.
Right. Do you see in the picture where the function changes its mind? Right? Right there at 2. To the left of 2, it's this negatively sloping line. To the left of 2. To the right of 2, it's this positively sloping line. At 2 is where it changes its mind. Here at greater or equal to 2, it's 3x minus 6. And here, it is this. So does everyone see how the function changes its mind? Okay, so then that means that we're going to integrate this, and we're going to break the integral from 0 to 5 into two integrals. What two integrals? 0 to 2 and 2 to 5.
But do we have to flip the limit on the negative
side? We're about to see.
Okay.
So the integral from 0 to 5 of absolute 3x minus 6 dx is integral 0 to 2 of absolute 3x minus 6 dx plus integral 2 to 5 absolute 3x minus 6. And you might look at this line and say, well, it appears to me that we have doubled our problem. What problems we had, they are now double. Well, between 0 and 2, because we're only integrating between 0 and 2, that means that now we are allowed to select one of these. Which one can we select for this one? The negative one, right? So this is integral 0 to 2 negative 3x minus 6 dx plus. And because on this integral, on this one, we're only between 2 and 5, that means that we can now select one of these two. Which one?
3x.
The top one, right? 3x minus 6. And notably, I hope you remember what I said at the beginning of this exercise. I said that we started with an integral. This and this function we're integrating has no antiderivative. It has no antiderivative. But now we have two integrals, which is worse, but no absolute values. And now both of these have antiderivatives, which means that we can use the fundamental theorem on these now. Okay, we can use the fundamental theorem once, twice. Okay, so does everybody see the trade-off? Okay, so let's do it. So I'll spend this negative to do what?
Come outside.
Yeah, it can come outside if you like, and then I'll spend it to do what?
The 0 and the 2.
Very good, to flip those two. Okay, so then this will be integral 2 to 0, 3x minus 6, dx, plus 2 to 5, 3x minus 6. Now both of these, we can compute their antiderivatives, so this would be 3 halves x squared minus 6x from 2 to 0 plus 3 halves x squared minus 6x from 2 to 5. Okay, any question getting to this position?
Quite a few, but I'm okay.
Okay. So now, the arithmetic from here would be absolutely glorious, I'm sure. But I'm just going to omit it and say that you should practice that, maybe, if you can stomach it. And what's the answer? We know what the answer has to be.
Over
39 over 2. And you should check that to make sure you can go through that arithmetic circus to get 39 over 2.
I can see how that.
Okay. Oh no, I forgot an x.
Okay, so any question about this one?
I have a question.
Yes?
I see when I look at the graph, when you're selecting the limit, you're going to do 0.5.
Yes? Well, what will happen, we're going to do many more of these. Like on Tuesday, we're going to do more interesting variations of this. And in the end, the breaks come where you have solutions to an equation. So what can and will happen is you'll end up solving an equation and you might have like two solutions, which means that you'll have to break it into three pieces. Right, 1, 2, 3, because there were two fence posts. That was not an exciting answer, but it is the answer.
To but that will just tell us where it is. If the x is greater or equal to 2, that should tell us.
Right.
But if there's 2, then we have to do a sign chart, right?
Yes, you do.
We have to do a what now?
Sign. You will.
Okay.
It'll be terrific.
And then we're going to look at whether or not the maximum and min and all that?
No.
Because then we'll know if whether it's sloping up or sloping down.
We won't do that. We won't do that.
And how can we know whether or not
To appease your curiosity, but we're not doing this, but to appease your curiosity, I could say, you know, find the area bounded between the parabola and the line. And here the line is above the parabola.
Oh.
And here the parabola is above the line. So you have to figure out where that changes. It changes there. And we'll do that next time. And we'll find that place by solving an equation.
So from here on out, we're going to be doing this. It's just going to get more complicated, right?
We are going to use the fundamental theorem for the rest of the semester. It is, and I'm saying that you have it right. We're going to do the fundamental theorem as many ways as possible. Okay, so let's keep going.
How did you decide you enjoyed calculus?
I thought I was going to be a physician, and then I realized that I wasn't able to memorize all the things that physicians need to memorize. Yeah. So I'm much better with knowing a very short list of facts and a lot of consequences of those facts, rather than physician knowledge, which is knowing an enormous body of facts that don't have that many consequences. Right. So just the shape of the knowledge of a physician is quite wide, but not deep. The shape of the knowledge of a mathematician is somewhat narrow, but very deep.
What about either of those? I'm a business student.
You could be a VA.
It takes all kinds, right? I lost my place. Okay, here we go. So, for example, find the area between y is x squared minus 4 and the x-axis. On 0 to 4. So find the area between y is x squared minus 4 and the x-axis on the interval 0 to 4.
Right.
So what is the plot of y is x squared minus 4? What is it?
Interval from 0 to 4.
We are going to do something like that, but just the shape of this plot. What is this? Parabola. Opens up. Shifted down. Good. So. You got to know these things.
Do we have to, though? That's what I'm saying. Like, have to? Like, you're going to test me on it?
Yeah, basically, yeah. Okay. So it's a parabola that opens up.
Like that, I know.
Because it has a positive leading coefficient.
I don't know.
And how do we know if it's to the right or to the left?
It's down.
It's down, but if it were to the right, it would be...
It would have to be x minus something. It would be, if it was something like x minus 3 squared, then it would be shifted to the right 3. Okay, so we've got a parabola. It's supposed to be symmetric. Okay, then on the interval 0 to 4. Okay, so I'll say that that's 4 because I can't go any higher. Okay, so this is x is 0. This is x is 4. And what is the x-axis? This thing, right?
Oh yeah.
You know,
it is.
2 hours.
What's the trick?
2 hours and 15 minutes of a math course is really too long. But, you know, like, human beings actually only have an attention span of, like, 15 minutes. Really. Like, for something that's.
15 minutes. We got you.
Yeah, for 15 minutes, yeah. And that's if you're interested in the topic at hand. That's about how long that you can have uninterrupted attention. Okay, two hours and 15 minutes is just, it's a joke. But whatever. So we want to find the area.
That was not a good closing on that day.
I mean, honestly, like.
You want an education, right?
You should see my parabola.
So what area is being requested?
0 to 4.
Between 0 and 4, and between the parabola and the x-axis. Yeah, so this is between the parabola and the x-axis.
I'm confused.
No, above and to the right.
No, well, 0 to 4.
And above and to the right.
Above and to the right.
So there's two different areas. Yeah, so it's a good question, right? Do you see that it's important to know that point? We've got to know that. So
you would square the x squared minus 4, right? That would give us 2.
Not quite. So this
or y equals 0?
Yes. This is the plot of y is x squared minus 4. And what is this? This is y is what?
0.
Y is 0. Because you want to know where this graphite axis and this red touch, looking at a picture, when you want to know when two plots are touching, that's equivalent to solving an equation. You need to know when this y is that y. So you need to know when x squared minus 4 is 0. That's what you need to know. So we need to find the intersection. The intersection of y is 0 and y is x squared minus 4. So that means we need to solve 0 is x squared minus 4. So 0 is x plus 2. times x minus 2. So x is negative 2 or x is 2. So which one is the one we're looking for? 2, right?
Positive 2.
This one is over here. It's not part of the exercise. Okay? So this point here okay, so then, does everyone see how this is going to end up being worked out? So what are we going to have to do? We've got a green area, and we've got a blue area. So we need to find the green area and also the blue area. Okay, so then, how will we find the green area?
It's not a triangle.
It's not a triangle, right? Give up.
So we find the green area by making squared minus
4
negative?
Yes. So let's look at this for a moment. If we just wanted to find the blue area for a moment to make it a little simpler, what would you have to do to find the blue area?
We'd have to do the integral of
2 to 4.
X squared minus 4 dx.
Of the parabola. If you integrated from 2 to 4, the parabola, that would give you the blue area. And I think what you were saying is that we apparently can't integrate 0 to 2, the parabola, to get the green area? Why not?
We don't know the tangent line.
Because what's negative?
The area is negative.
Yeah.
The area is negative.
Remember what that proposition a few pages ago said. When does the integral represent area? When the function that you are integrating is never negative. Right? So notice what does negative mean in a picture?
Below the x-axis.
Do you observe that this function, the parabola, is below the x-axis?
Yes.
The function is negative here. If you integrate from 0 to 2, you will not get the green area. What will you get? No, not that.
Oh, you wouldn't?
If you integrated the parabola from 0 to 2, you would not get the green area, you'd get its negation. You would get, so if that green area is 5, you'd get negative 5, is what you'd get.
Well, then we could just negate that.
Then you negate it to get the answer.
Okay.
So, what we need to do is that the answer, if you take my meaning, right, is this plus this, right? That one plus that one. Okay, so then for the first one, so integral from 0 to 2 of x squared minus 4 dx, and then plus integral 2 to 4 of x squared minus 4 dx. So this is not quite right. How do I need to fix this up?
You need to negate the first one.
Why do we negate the first one? Do we always negate the first one?
No, below the x-axis.
Yeah, because this one. Very good, because this one is under the axis. So this. Yes?
How long does it take to tell that, I guess, simulation without seeing the graph? Is there a way to look at the problem?
Not really.
So we'll have to
draw
the graph.
So it's negative because it's below the axis.
Oh gosh.
So there in math there's this you know, there's a lot of way to break down a math problem, but sort of broadly speaking, you can break it into two ways. You can say you can try and understand a math problem geometrically, like with pictures, or you can try and understand it analytically, that is to say, like with lots of equations and things like this. And my teaching experience has told me that every person has a preference. Either they're either geometric people or analytic people. And that preference may not necessarily mean that you like one more than the other. It may just mean that you dislike one less than the other. Okay, so then every one of you has a bias. You either like the geometry or the analytic way. This course I'm going to select exercises which specifically make you do one or the other or both. And the reason is because you need to be good at both. Because the split, in my experience, is about 50-50. The odds are, if you like the analytic point of view, that you're sitting next to or at least close to someone who likes the geometric point of view. People looking at each other crossways like, And you're going to go out and use this techniques, you know, or at least, you know, maybe, you know, hopefully, right? And the odds are that you're going to be talking to someone who has the opposite preference of you. And if you're an analysis person, if you like equations, and you're talking to a geometry person, someone who likes pictures, you're going to have to be able to converse with them. Because graphing calculators robs you of understanding what it is.
But every other school allows you to use graphing calculators.
But this is not every other school. This is UT Dallas.
But how
about UT Dallas?
I'm supposed to know what X square and Y square looks like. What if I don't know what
that is? Is it because you should know graph cheating?
No, because they clear on the testing center.
It is. The problem is that if you don't know what these look like, I mean, it would be like saying, if you didn't know any words in Russian, but you knew all of the syntax, and every single time you wanted to say a sentence in Russian, you had to use a dictionary. If I took that dictionary away from you, you would be unable to converse. And so I claim that at that point you don't know how to speak Russian. So it's the same thing here. If I give you a calculator and you can plot it, and if I take it away from you, you can't proceed, then I claim that you don't know this. And it is also my point, is that you have to be able to do this without the aid of the machine. Okay. So, any question about why we get to here?
Quick question, but it's a little different. Okay, assuming it is totally flipped, if it was a negative parabola, would you take the negative of the opposite because it would be...
Whatever parts are under the axis.
Okay. It doesn't matter. Okay.
Right. Whatever parts happen to be under the axis. Yes? So if we had a picture that looked like this, so this is a separate example now. If we had a picture that looked like this, and I said, find the area between the function and the x-axis. And I said, do it between these two fence posts. Then do you see that there's a variety of contained areas? So I ask you, would we need to negate the integral for this one?
No,
because this one is above. So we'd compute integral from here to here, and then here's a separate region. Would we need to negate the integral of this region?
Yes,
because it is below. How about this one? Would we negate?
No,
because it's above. Would we negate this one?
Yes.
Yes, because it's below. Would we negate this one? No, because it's above. And the last one?
Yes,
because it's below. Is that it? That answers it?
Yes.
Other questions?
Wait, I have another question.
Yes?
Remind me again why we chose this pose. I know how to draw these graphs.
Okay.
Remind me again why we chose those two sections, those two particular, well, not, and not the other little section on the other side.
This?
Yeah.
Because it says 0 to 4. And that's 0 and that's 4. If it had said from negative 2 to 4, then we would have, yeah. Other questions? Okay, so we've got these two integrals and they're getting lonely now. So let's do them. So this would be what? So I'll negate this one. I'll spend that negative to get it to be 2 to 0. X squared minus 4 dx. Plus this one just copied. So then the integral is x cubed over 3 minus 4x. Evaluated from 2 to 0, plus x cubed over 3, minus 4x, evaluated from 2 to 4. Any question about that, getting to there? Okay, so then now it's just a bunch of boring arithmetic. So let's do it. If we plug in 0, we get 0, so that's nice. Minus 8 over 3 minus 8. And then plus, if we plug in 4, that's 64 over 3 minus 16. And if we plug in 2, we again get this 8 over 3 minus 8. Okay, any question about those evaluations? Okay, so this is, so that's 0 minus this, so then this one would be 8 minus 8 over 3, and then plus, wow, look at all this. Okay, so that'd be 64 over 3 minus 48 over 3. And then, a regular calculator will do this. If it was easy, then everyone would take calculus.
If I told you I'm being forced against my will.
Duress.
If you're taking this course under duress, then yeah, you should seek assistance.
I decided I was going to change my major to dance because it's about. I think I'll be about as successful.
So I've lost my place here.
Sorry.
Okay, so this 8 with that 8 is 16 over 3.
Well, wait.
Yeah. So I'm going to take this 8 and this 8 and combine them into 16 over 3. I'm going to take this minus 8 over 3 and minus 8 over 3 and combine them to be negative 16 over 3. I'm going to take this one and make this what?
16 over 3.
Plus 16 over 3.
No, where did you get the first 16 over
3? Yeah.
I don't know.
8 plus 8 should just be 16.
8 plus 8 is 48 over 3.
Okay, that works better.
Okay, and then this is... Now I'm totally messed up.
You only have 3. You're done. You just actually...
Those
cancel each other out.
My brain is just totally scrambled.
Yeah.
16.
Us
Oh, we're out of time. It was all right. Have a nice weekend.